Okay, so I'm Liz Oliver from the University of Liverpool, and I'd just like to pick up on that point about fixed-term contracts and open-ended contracts in the cross survey. I think very much we need to be looking at really at the quality of appointments and moving away perhaps from making this distinction always between fixed-term and open-ended. I think the landscape is changing a little bit, and so we need to be thinking about the kind of the quality of appointments. So not all fixed-term contracts are going to be bad, not all open-ended contracts are going to be good. And I think so we need to be thinking about looking really at the quality of the position. But I do think this is still an issue, but perhaps the issue's moving on and we need to think about it in that way. So thanks.
Thank you. Sue, I don't know whether you want to start, because you raised some very interesting points in your presentation, which was that you were now looking at using more flexible types of contracts. Have you got any reflections on?
I think I'd rather not, given that this is going to be broadcast on YouTube and things later on. I feel a commitment to my staff. I've got an all-staff meeting tomorrow morning, which actually, if they see this today, they won't know about that staff meeting till tomorrow morning. So can I not say anything on
Absolutely.
That one?
Sean, what about EUCU perspective on this?
Well, I think that the straightforward point that I wanted to make was that, however, whatever the legal framework of the contractual relationship, if you're a member of staff working for a university, you are an employee of that university, and universities have legal obligations in dealing with your contract. But from a research point of view, your job security and your quality of research and your ability to build a research career is going to be developed dependent on your relationship with your PI and what the last speaker described as the research environment. And so, of course, you can have a situation where people have technically a fixed-term contract but are treated to all intents and purposes as being of equal esteem to a permanent lecturer. And you can also have people who, because they have a fixed-term contract, are treated essentially as somebody who's perpetually in training and who can expect to have to defend their job every couple of years or over a shorter period of time. And I just think that creates a great deal of stress, as Sue described, for the staff concerned. And it's very distracting. It also means that people leave. I mean, people leave in the middle of projects. My colleague has just left for a less secure job in some respects, but not in research. And she didn't want to leave, but she just felt that she, you know, given the alternative of staying in research, she found that it was, she'd prefer to be doing something where there wasn't the expectation that she was going to be made redundant when that project ended. And I just think institutions have got to kind of wake up and smell the coffee over this question. I think it's a no-brainer, to be honest, that if you value your staff, you don't expect that they just leave, or large proportions of them do. And the figures are actually quite scary, that currently at UCL, the figures that we've been given from our management is that every quarter, 10% of research staff are likely to either be told that they're going to be made redundant or are being placed in that position. And that's extremely stressful. That means that 35-40% of people over a year are in that situation. That is a huge distraction, and it creates a high level of churn in the organisation, and that can't be good for long-term research.
Thank you. Anybody else on the panel with comments? Liz, it might be quite useful for those of you who don't know, Liz is currently working on a project that's examining the use of fixed-term contracts across the UK. And I know you've done a workshop on that, but would you be able to give some quick headline information about what that project is showing?
Okay, yeah, that's fine.
Put you on the spot.
So I'm working on this project and really just trying to get a feeling really for how universities and individuals who are working in universities are responding to the legislation on fixed-term employment. And what I've been doing is a kind of little bit of background research on the policies that universities have in relation to fixed term employment, and going to follow that up with some institutional case studies to really sort of, you know, get to the nitty gritty of what's happening on the ground and see what's happening to the law now that it's kind of out there and then being implemented in different contexts. So the main feeling that I have so far is that, you know, things are moving on, things are developing, and so, you know, a lot of institutions are moving towards using some open-ended contracts. And so I think the point that I wanted to make earlier was just that this distinction really between fixed term and open-ended isn't the be-all and end-all, and we need to look at things in a kind of broader context of And the point about people being in control of their own career progression really and their career plans really fits into that kind of broader context and understanding things in that context. So far, I've just been sort of looking really at how universities are beginning to respond and trying to develop some sort of, trying to identify really some key policy features and some different approaches. And I'm in the process of kind of trying to hone that up and then really sort of get at what's going on the ground through these institutional case studies. So that's all I can say so far. It's work in progress. And if anyone wants to come and find me to talk about the project or to hear some further information, please do so. I've got a little website with a little bit of information on there. And so, yeah, I'm happy to share that.
Thanks, Liz. That's really helpful. Okay. Okay, any more questions or comments?
Yeah,
okay, if we take a couple of questions and then we'll respond in a group.
I'm Charles Marriott from the University of Scotland. Sean's ideas of how to manage and cope with staff between contracts, as it were, are very interesting. But it seems to me that that implies a change in culture towards thinking much more in terms of research programs. Mm-hmm. And the dual support system is geared towards the funding council supporting research infrastructure and those permanent staff, the PIs and so on, going out and finding funding for research projects. And if we're to get this greater stability, and crucially from the point of view of universities, to cut down on this huge inefficiency, there needs to be a switch towards more emphasis on thinking of research programs. Now, is the dual support system cut out to do that? And if not, how should it change?
Okay, anybody else with questions? I take a group. Yeah. There's two here.
Neil Wolford, Institute of Cancer Research. Having spent a day in the company of people worried about what's happening with the Roberts funding for transferable skills, the research and development agenda, I was very interested in Graham's comments that the REF is going to take account of postgraduate provision development of research skills. On the one hand, are they totally confused about is this important or not? Or secondly, maybe I'm giving them far more credit than due, is this joined up thinking, i.e. if that money goes, we then make it important to the institutions to do this themselves, to plug the gap, because this is now linked to the REF. So is it a masterstroke or is it confusion?
Or both.